Brandon, give me a sense of what you think this James Harden trade means for Kyrie Irving.
An added piece, you know, a buddy of mine in Kendrick Perkins said to on Twitter the other day that you know, James Harden and Kevin Durant coming in, one is Batman, one is Robin, and Kyrie is Alfred. But the only thing there is, Kyrie has a championship, Kevin has a championship, James is trying to win one. And so when I look at that piece of the puzzle, I actually think the bridging of Kyrie KD with Kevin, or Kyrie KD, because Kevin's the same person, Kyrie KD with James together is kind of on James's onus to kind of bring an extra step, because Kevin and Kyrie have been there. So I think more than anything else, it's just finding roles. You know, you look at James and Kyrie, they're both playmakers. And when you look at what Kyrie basically did in Cleveland as a point guard, he played alongside LeBron James, who was a playmaker who came in the league as a point guard. And Kyrie had to, I don't want to say adjust, but he found a way to blend with the playmaker that and scorer that LeBron is. So when you look at Kevin Durant and you look at Kyrie, Kevin doesn't have to be the primary ball handler. I think the good thing about that situation in Brooklyn, you as a ball player, you playing in college, you know, guys find a way to adjust, knowing when to pick their spots, when to shoot. I mean, it's no different. These guys played in USA basketball together, so they're very familiar with their styles of play, and how to go about it. I think the biggest strength that the Nets do have is an added scorer and a 3-point shooter who happens to be able to be a playmaker. But the funny thing about that situation is Kevin and Kyrie were kind of just the man coming out of college. James was a late bloomer in so many ways. You know, James was a guy that came into his, he kind of was like Tracy McGrady when he left Toronto, comparatively. Like, Tracy was in a situation in Toronto where it was Vince Carter's team, and then he went to Orlando, and Grant Hill getting hurt, it became his team. I mean, even from the perspective, I'm a little too close, so I say this with candor, but not to out anybody. James did everything differently when he went to Houston. You know, the girls started paying attention to him. He got his teeth fixed. He was a prolific scorer. He left Oklahoma and became a star in Houston.
Yeah.
Bree and Kevin naturally had that because they were the man coming out of college. So it's a different situation coming to Brooklyn. Everybody talks about the strip clubs, and everybody talks about you know, just the bravado that comes with James Harden. I think when you have two basketball minds together, or three now, they're just gonna find a way to get it done. That's the long form answer to your question.
No, I yeah, for sure. No, that and it makes sense. You bring up an interesting point we talked about yesterday when we were just reacting to the trade. When it comes to Kevin Durant, when you look at these three stars, I what you just said is so interesting, because like when you see even like two stars come together, but when it's three, it's really like the okay, who's gonna sacrifice, right? The word always comes up, like who's gonna be the Chris Bosh or the Kevin Love, right? Scoop, these three. This is not Bosh, LeBron, Wade. This is not Love. This isn't like a clear hierarchy. Like, and I agree with you in terms of you got two who have a ring, and James, who's ringless, but his individual success and talent is right there with the other two. So it's not to say one is more important than the other, but when you look at the balance of power, there will be sacrifices made. What you just said makes me wonder, and I'll ask you to kind of just elaborate on your thoughts on this. Do you think Kevin Durant will be the one to kind of sacrifice and say, okay, for the sake of this working, I'll be the one? Because to your point, and I agree, we talked about this, KD is really the one who has shown that he will sacrifice the most. Even in Golden State, you know, people argue who's the best player, KD or Steph, whatever. It really didn't matter. But ultimately, it came down to like KD, he was the one who hit the shot over LeBron. They won two straight when he went there, but he didn't play selfish basketball there, Scoop. He fit into the system. Now, at times, he was able to take over and be KD. That's who he is. But I feel like he's even in OKC, people got on him because he was so efficient. He would get his points, but he wasn't taking more shots than Westbrook. That just wasn't who he was. So do you think that KD will be the one to kind of say, all right, I'll kind of step back. I'll still get my 25, 30, but let me make sure that you guys are comfortable and just doing what you guys do.
I think that what makes it different than Golden State with Kevin or Miami with LeBron, Wade, and Bosh, and even Cleveland with Kyrie, LeBron, and Love, honestly, is the fact that you have three perimeter guys. Kyrie, even being the point guard that he is, at times can naturally shift to the two positions.
But only one of them can play big, right? I mean, they're all perimeter guys, but KD. Kevin,
yeah, if you play, you and I both come from Division III Eastern University, and we know all about small ball. That being said, you're right. When you look at Kevin can play big. Kevin legitimately can come in and be that four. I mean, coming into the season, we knew that, you know, before Jared Allen, and I really think I'm going to miss Jared Allen in Brooklyn substantially, just because I think a lot of Nets fans were crowning him as the next – or the next big center after Brook Lopez. But I think when you look at just what Kevin brings to the table, we know what he can bring to the table. We know he can play big. We know he can shoot. I mean, that game against the Knicks the other night was literature. It was just good to watch. He's just a basketball savant. And I think that the one thing that I can say about this situation is, I don't know that it's necessarily a conscious effort to say, okay, I'm gonna fall back, because there's probably gonna be some nights where they're gonna need him to score 50, right? And then there may be some nights where if he's scoring those 50, James is dishing out 13, 14, 15 assists, right? But then say they're playing against Denver and it's a Kyrie matchup against Jamal Murray, Kyrie's gonna go off. As our sisters would say, go off then. So I think at the end of the day, like, I think it's a situation where it's a game-by-game decision. Yeah. I think that these guys are not just saying, like, I think, like, again, you played, I didn't, but I think like y'all. I think at the end of the day, it's a situation of a game-by-game basis. And just spending time with Kai and KD, I use this example all the time. My reporting back in 2018, you know, kind of definitively said Kevin was going to Los Angeles, and what ultimately changed was me spending time with Kevin and Kyrie in Charlotte in 2019 at the Jordan Brand party. And I was standing there talking with them and just watching their chemistry. Everything was jokes, ha ha, hee hee. And just that whole weekend, they developed the chemistry. And really, that was I can tell you that after that Jordan Brand party, it was a discussion that whole weekend about teaming together. And that was February of 2019. The good thing about that situation is Kevin having prior experience playing alongside James in Oklahoma. It's funny, I spent about a week in Oklahoma. I was with Russell Westbrook the day he was traded, and kind of was introduced to some things that I did not know. Specifically, I remember being in Oklahoma and being out there for a week and learning in 2012 how much those guys were young, they were ripe, but they weren't really serious. Like, serious in a way that they may be serious now about contending for an NBA championship. I mean, you talk about James Harden partying. I've heard that, you know, during that time when they were playing against the Miami Heat, you know, they would spend time partying in Miami and then go right to the finals. I don't know the time frame, but I know that that was something that was discussed as it relates to just them being young, but having success early in the game. As you know, sometimes you could be around the greatest of men or women in this world and not necessarily have the mental capacity to appreciate it, process it, or understand it. Kind of similarly to LeBron and the Cavs going to the finals in 2007 and playing an experienced Spurs, playing against the Spurs in the 2007 NBA Finals and playing against an experienced Tim Duncan, Tony Parker, Manu Ginobili, who was coached by Greg Popovich. So when you look at this situation with Brooklyn, it does two things. One, it pits the Lakers and the Nets against each other, potentially. This is about as Biggie and Pac as it comes. This is about as Dre and everybody else you could imagine as it comes, East Coast, West Coast, except Biggie, there was no Brooklyn Nets when Biggie was alive. In fact, he lived in Bergen County, New Jersey, and would sometimes be spotted at the old Continental Airlines Arena or Brendan Burns Arena in East Rutherford, New Jersey. But I feel like at the end of the day, when you look at this Nets situation, it's the Oklahoma City Thunder remix. The only thing missing was Serge Ibaka. You know, Serge was looking at, you know, the Brooklyn Nets and ultimately signed with the Clippers. And, you know, this talk of, you know, Russell Westbrook leaving Washington and coming to Brooklyn. I don't think that that's the case just yet. I think that there are some things behind the scenes as it relates to Kyrie that have to be figured out. But I do ultimately think that these guys can find a way to win. Now, here's the other thing. You got three open roster spots. Jamal Crawford is somebody that the Nets could be going after, sources say. In addition to that, you know, you look at some of the other pieces like Dwayne Dedman. You look at Tyson Chandler. You look at Isaiah Thomas. You need some veteran leadership, as it was said to me by a close source. The Nets, if they're looking for some sort of OG role, you know, they need kind of like a Jared Dudley or, you know, a Carmelo Anthony type of OG, someone that's not in a suit, but someone who is respected. And I think that that is significant for how they continue to build out this roster. I think these are conversations we thought we'd be having pre-training camp that are now coming to fruition in the new year.
Last question, based on what's happened, based on your knowledge and anything you're hearing around the Nets organization and just the vibe of things with James Harden coming in, what are the expectations in terms of the championship meter? And I'll start with the East. Just from your perspective, where are they now in terms of how they stack in terms of winning the East, and what are their title contention possibilities now?
Well, I mean, even before this trade, Martin, the Nets were expected to be, you know, in the mix as it relates to, you know, the top tier of Eastern Conference teams. I think nobody expected the 76ers to come out as smoking hot as they did. I also think that when you look at the Eastern Conference, you know, you still have to respect the current Eastern or the reigning Eastern Conference champions in the Miami Heat, who had an interesting start to their season. But, you know, you'd hope that they kind of get their situation together. Giannis Antetokounmpo and the Milwaukee Bucks are, you know, were supposed to be the Eastern Conference champions last season. So Miami had something to say about that. But, you know, you look at the Brooklyn Nets, you know, like I said, pre-trade with James Harden, they were still, you know, they still were expected to be in the mix. You know, I use this example often, not to just sound monotonous and to just spew off everything everybody else has said, but I look at the Nets last year. Reminds me a lot of the Lakers, the first year LeBron was there. You know, you look at that first year with the Lakers, you know, LeBron and that whole area that they some people said sports hernia, myriad of other things, which ultimately put the Lakers in a position where they were able, because they didn't make the playoffs, and able to make, you know, a valiant trade to bring in Anthony Davis, because they got a first round pick. They shipped Lonzo Ball. They shipped Brandon Ingram and others. And so when you look at the Nets comparatively, thoracic bursitis with Kyrie Irving and, you know, him not playing, the bubble happened and more. Kevin Durant's, you know, not playing last season and resting. And now you look at this season, Kevin's back. Kyrie's dealing with some personal issues. And then during that time away, the Nets were able to facilitate a three-team trade with the Cleveland Cavaliers, the Houston Rockets, as well as themselves. The Sixers were buyers, the Heat were buyers, but the Heat weren't selling to those guys. And, you know, ultimately it came down to that three-team trade. And the Cavaliers got better as well. I think that's so underly reported, or not really given as much attention as it should, because it's Cleveland and LeBron is not there. But You know, when you look at the Nets overall, I think there are some things that mirror the Lakers. The only difference is I was looking at Caris LeVert to kind of be everything in Brooklyn that the Lakers fandom thought Kyle Kuzma would be last season. And ultimately, though, and I'm not comparing your styles, I'm just talking about the third star. Ultimately, I do think that Caris will look good in Indiana. I mean, he's wore any variation of maize and blue already as a member or as a Michigan Wolverine. So that yellow blue combination will naturally fit him. And I really do think that Caris LeVert is going to be a legitimate star in this league, man. I mean, just his ability in the playoffs or, you know, against Toronto, he carried that team. Times where, you know, Kyrie and Kevin weren't playing last season, he stepped up. He scored 50 points against the Celtics in the regular season. I really do think that it must suck to have to hear your name in trade talks all the time. As you know, Drew Holiday was a player that the Nets were looking at, as I reported. This goes as far back as, you know, the trade deadline. You know, this is a guy that, you know, Drew ultimately went to the Bucks, a team that was also interested in him. But Caris, you know, there was talk about Houston, and the way it was said to me by a close source yesterday is, imagine what would have happened if Spencer Dinwiddie did not tear his ACL. He probably would have been gone. But I think there is something about that Nets team that Spencer Dinwiddie, God's hand must be on him, because he really embodies that spirit of Brooklyn and really was there during the D'Angelo Russell years. And when things weren't necessarily, you know, blockbuster attractions. So I know I'm rambling, but I do think that the Nets, I think that the NBA would benefit from a New York, Los Angeles matchup. I don't see the Knicks making that type of noise anytime soon. The Clippers, to me, have a good roster, but the Lakers also got better in the offseason. So here we are.
Last question, the only question I have for you as it relates to Kyrie Irving. Does he want to play with James Harden?
Yes.
Hands down, for sure.
Yes. Yes. I think, you know, the bigger issue is just Kyrie right now. There are a lot of circulating reports about a party, which I just want to give some clarity to. It wasn't a nightclub. His sister Asia turned 30 this week. His father, Frederick Irving, turned 55. And family is very important to Kyrie. I will tell you, just, you know, when he did his media availability last season, he talked about how he lost his grandfather and how big of a loss that was, and him playing in Boston. You know, he couldn't necessarily stop everything he was doing and come to the New York metropolitan area to see about him. And you know, now him playing for the Nets and him being a native of West Orange, New Jersey, he is, as one of my close friends says to me, he teases me, he calls me a crossbreeder because I grew up in both. So comparatively with Kai, I understand that notion of, you know, wanting to be close to your family and more, but now that nightclub, or as they call it, is 466 in West Orange, New Jersey. It is a catering hall, which kind of doubles as like they have a nightclub situation, but it was really close friends. And I think that in the media, because they don't necessarily understand Kai or know him, the optics is what plays a big role in that situation. We don't know how many people were in that nightclub, as they call it, but it was close family and friends. I think strobe lights, big TV screens, and no masks is what throws a lot of people off. And if you look at the NBA's protocol, they sent a over 150-page memo to all 30 teams where, you know, it was discussed the do's and don'ts. And what I'll say to you is, I think that with Kyrie, because he's misunderstood, because he doesn't talk on record to media, and because there's just this cloud of the world not being round, everybody's mad. He thinks differently. But ultimately, you got to communicate better. You got to talk. And that pawn comment for a lot of media members, they were upset. I use this analogy. It's not a complete cookie cutter example, but I remember a lot of police officers being angry when Colin Kaepernick wore socks where you had pigs with police uniforms on. And a lot of media people that I have spoken to took that pawn comment personally. And those are the people that have to convey a message. So I think with this trade for James Harden, it offers and ushers in a fresh start. And I think Kyrie Irving will rise to the occasion. I mean, this is a guy that at 28 years old has accomplished more than some 40-year-olds have accomplished. You're talking, you know, NBA champion. You're talking rookie of the year. You're talking gold medalist. You're talking all-star MVP. You know, I think the social justice stuff, the NBA stuff, you can do both. But I think it's the optics that's confusing to many people. I'll use this example, not clear-cut example, but Deion Sanders was able to play baseball and football. Kyrie Irving can be a social justice activist and agent for change and an NBA champion at the same time. And I think that winning cures all. If we can forget about Tom Brady and Deflategate, you damn sure could forget about any transgressions or miscommunications on whether he suited up to play against the Sixers, the Memphis Grizzlies, the Oklahoma City Thunder, and New York Knicks in a week span. And I want to see Kyrie do well. You know, I think, me personally, I'm rooting for him. I'm rooting for Kevin. As a writer, you know, you want to see a team do well, particularly because you know that a team like the Nets, you know, for years has been the laughingstock of the New York metropolitan area, has always been a little brother of the Knicks. And, you know, the Knicks had a fast start. The Nets took care of business the other night. And, you know, I want to see those guys do well, man. So, you know, James Harden coming in, Kevin coming in, and, you know, Kyrie and James are already friends, as well as Kevin being teammates with James. So it's going to be interesting, but, you know, I'm looking forward to a Lakers-Nets matchup come finals time.
This is actually the last question in general and on Kyrie, but you don't think an early retirement is would actually be on the table, do you?
I'm not sure. I think that at the end of the day, I think that the Nets and Kyrie Irving, whatever issues are behind the scenes that we don't know, that I don't know, need to be worked out. But I think that it's easy to point the finger at somebody who's misunderstood because everybody's the same. We preach to be different. We preach to be different all the time. But then when someone's different, you question it. I think that Kyrie and Steve Nash, just from my vantage point, nothing I've heard, just from observations. When I look at Steve Nash and I look at Kyrie Irving, they're both great point guards that played in their era and at some point were competitors. You know, Steve and Kyrie weren't necessarily equal competitors because Steve was towards the end of his career when Kyrie entered. But I do think that oftentimes players who play the same position as their coach did clash. And I think that what makes Kai special is what he can do with the basketball, both scoring, both playmaking, and just being a presence on the floor. And what made Steve Nash special was his ability to make players around him better. And because they both want some of the same things, they clash. I spoke with someone over the summertime just about Steve Nash's presence in Brooklyn. And more specifically about why the Nets hired him. And I will share with you a story. So, number one, the person that I spoke with said to me, Steve Nash is probably he could run for president or be a United Nations representative if he wanted to be, just because he consults with so many different people that are smarter than him. And he may not be the smartest person in the world, but because he has smart people around him, it makes him look better. But also, he listens. And in his personal life, Kyrie Irving, to me, is the same way. He's smart, but he may not be the smartest person in the world, but he surrounds himself around smarter people. His KAI Foundation, he employs his sister, his best friends, and more. I think he has an interest in helping people. He has the ability to listen. He does listen. But I think that the NBA restarting at the point in which it did, with minimal training camp, and ultimately these championship aspirations, with a new coach, Kevin returning from Achilles injury, Kyrie returning from a thoracic bursitis shoulder injury. It's a lot to digest. And I'd rather somebody get their blunders or their mess ups earlier in the season and the miscommunication and getting all of that out now than it be middle of the season, end of the season. So I think what you're seeing is growing pains from players. Again, you played, I didn't play, but I'm an observer and I've been around all y'all my whole life. And I just think that at the end of the day, I think the Nets can get it together. And I think that James Harden coming to Brooklyn offers a new life that I'm excited to see.
Scoob,
my man.
Always appreciate your time, bro. Thank you, man.